us. But we wanted to do this in celebrating Ron with one of his favorite songs. So we're going to play that song, and I'm going to invite you, if you have great voices, and you can sing loud, and I think that we want to join the chorus of heaven and join in singing this song. So we're going to play it. I'm going to invite you to stand up.
Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away.
Come on.
To a home on God's celestial shore, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by,
live with him. Can you sit down? Thank you. Right now, we're going to do a slideshow in celebration of Ron's life, and we're going to get to see bits and pieces of the fun and amazing adventure Ron lived. Check this out.
Ooh, heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're good Father, it's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you, it's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. Oh, and I can hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am.
Pastor Bob, he's going to share something with us today.
At that wedding. And come on, guys, it's okay to laugh. And so the only critical thing I said to him after the wedding is, Ron, that wig is certainly not you. But Ron had a sense of humor. He was a good man. And I want to say this. There are people that come to God from a bad life, and they're not good people, and they're evil people, and they turn to God, and God changes them. I believe Ron, all of his life, even before he came to God, was a good man. Is right, Debbie? That he was a good man. He had a good character. He was a kind and soft-spoken person, and I want to give a story that happened to me, but I want to keep the focus on Ron. I got into church in Frankfort, Kansas, as eighth grader, and there was a lady in our church that would let us kids come out to her farm in Kansas and just run through the hills and play. And so she became a special person. She was a widow, husband had died, and my pastor was a woman, and her son, 3 years younger than me, so we enjoyed going out to Grace's house out in the country. The years went forward. In 1961, my pastor moved to Houston, and I followed a couple years later and went to college. And about 7-8 years ago, I flew down to Houston to see her, and I call her my stepmom, but my pastor. And she handed me a postcard, and it was addressed to Grace in Frankfort, Kansas. And she said, I have sent her postcards for years, and I accidentally sent this. I said, well, she's been gone on to heaven a lot of years. And she said, I know that, but it was just routine, and I just sent her one. And so I handed the envelope back to my pastor, and she said, no, I want you to look at it. And I looked at the envelope again, and someone there in Frankfort, Kansas had written on it, no longer at this address. And you're not going to find Ron in Hermiston, Oregon, or Seaside, or Wenatchee, Washington. He's moved. His address has changed. And I don't believe it's Montana either, so he's gone. And Ron was, what I would say, every pastor's hope and desire for a man in a church. He taught a class for 3 or 4 years on men and women, be armor bearers for your pastors. Protect them, back them. And the other side of that class was protect your church and promote your church, because God has planted you here. It's not wrong to promote your church. Where God has planted you, wants you to bloom. And supporting and giving. I'm going to ask my wife here in just a moment to come up. My wife's an ordained minister. I went to Bible college for 4 years. It took me 4 years to get through. It took her 2 years. So she has a degree. And Ron has a 2-year degree, and I'm going to ask her to tell you a little bit about that. A lot of people didn't realize that Ron had a Bible college degree. So I'm going to let her say a couple things here a little bit in just a moment. But I want to talk about Ron's family. And everybody gets really quiet. And Ron and Debbie, I'll start with both of them. They're the hardest working people I've ever seen, physically, on jobs, or in a church. And I walked through the dining room of our church the other day, and I see the paint that Debbie painted that dining room in our church. And she loved to decorate. She loved to work. And Ron, baseball, church softball, fireworks tent, you saw him there on the video, and things he's involved in. But now we're going to go down to his kids. And we'll start with the oldest first, I think, and follow sliding down. I never know when she's going to show up at the Wenatchee Valley College welding shop with something to fix. And it's usually some kind of a bicycle or exercise equipment. If I tried using it, I would die, you know. But she's one of these health fitness persons. And Paula's always had a smile. She's always had a loving attitude around people. And I appreciate it. I'm blessed to get to know her. And the next time you show up with a bicycle, we're going to charge you. And so now we go to Rich. Is Rich younger? Oh, I told everyone, I don't know Rich very well and didn't get to see him very much. I remember when he was not very old, he and hanging out over at the Aladdin's Castle video place in East Wenatchee. I don't know if he remembers that or not, me coming over there and visiting with him. Rich has done things that I think a lot of us envy. I asked Debbie, where is he? Well, he's in that part of the world, or he's in that part of the world. And I saw him a week ago, and I said, where are you now? You know? And the other thing is he was skinny as a rail. I used to weigh 127 pounds. I was skinny. He was worse, it looked like. And looks like he's getting 3 meals a day. Looks like he's exercising. And Rich, it was good to see you again. I just you and Paula, I haven't been around you much. I really don't know you much. And let's see, have I missed anyone? Oh, the Rugrat. And Tana, I got to see some pictures of you that I haven't seen before. And that was neat. Tana loves God, has been an example for all young people in her respect towards her parents and reverence for them. She has a passion for people that are not Christians to carry the gospel. I don't know how many mission trips she's gone on. She worked with YWAM, Youth with a Mission. I thought she was going to go to some exotic place, you know, like the islands where they had these 30-foot-long snakes, you know, that was going to eat her up, and she went to Iceland. And so there you have a little bit of a snapshot of Ron and Debbie's family. And there's a scripture that I can't remember exactly how it goes, and I don't know if you can project it up. It's Proverbs 10 and 7. In the first part, I went down to see the family, drove down the day that Ron left us, and reached over and pulled out a Gideon's Bible, and it opened up to this verse, and it just like the Lord said, this is for Debbie specifically, but also for the family. And are you able to project that up, or I can just tell them? The memory of the just is blessed. The Bible says that the death of the righteous is precious in God's sight. And your memory, Debbie, of this man and all of your family and your friends, Ron's friends, it's a blessed memory that you have of a good and godly person. And my heart goes out to you. I wonder if my wife, Deanna, could come up here. I pastor, but Dee actually was Ron's pastor. Working in the fireworks tent, when I was working, it seemed like Dee and Ron were doing fireworks tent, doing whatever, going to the Bible, taking Bible college.
Okay. Well, in our church, we have a saying. And for those of you that have been with us for a while, it says, God is good. And all the time. Amen. And Ron loved God with all his heart. And this is really going to be hard, but we had a Bible college, and it was a 2-year Bible college, and Debbie and Ron both were involved in it. And after 2 years, we graduated and went, several of us went for a ceremony over in Spokane. And there were things that were instilled. You know, when you learn to love the Lord and love His Word, it's something you carry with you. And it's something that is just projected from you. And one of the things that we had to do in our Bible college studies, we had to memorize a scripture every single week. And Ron was the thorn in everybody's flesh because he challenged every single one of us throughout the week to repeat and to recite that Bible scripture. Can you put that picture of him with the Bible scripture back up? You had it up when we first walked. There it is. And so now, when he would show up at church and Ron and Debbie would come into town, this was a scripture that Pastor Bob would challenge him with. And I want you to say it with me this morning, if you don't mind. It says, "The thief cometh not, but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life and they might have it more abundantly." Isn't that awesome? But he would just go from person to person and he'd say, "What's the scripture for this week?" But he learned and he loved the scripture. And he loved to teach. And as Pastor Bob said, he would talk about the armor bearer and the dispensations, yes. And monkey business. And one morning, monkey business was a class. Monkey business teaches you responsibility and how to handle a job, the do's, the don'ts. And one day, Ron comes in with this great big bag of monkeys. And everybody in the class, I think, got a monkey when they finished it. But it was something that he learned and carried through. And it's something that he, you know, carried through throughout his life. This is Ron to me right here. I want you to know. We ran a fireworks tent for 30-some years. And out of that, probably Ron was there half of those years at least. And he was very competitive, very competitive. And we would get these great big kits. And those things would be $100. We had a $400 one once. And we'd have these great big ones. And so Ron and I, we'd have different ones at the cash registers. And they would sell. And Ron and I are out working the crowd. And we're trying to see who's going to sell that big kit first. That was Ron. He was there to do his best. And he did it for the Lord. And it was such a wonderful thing because we were able to just meet so many different people. We had different camps that we were involved with. We had our Thanksgiving camp. We would all go camping together up, was it Grouse Creek? Grouse Creek up above Fish Lake. He loved to camp. Debbie loved to camp. And we just would have such a good time. But one of the things he loved to do is he'd cook breakfast for everybody. And I'll never forget that last Thanksgiving camp that we had. And him in the kitchen. And he had ordered a bunch of biscuits. And we had biscuits and gravy that morning. But yeah, this was him. He was always trying to please. He always had a smile. He had such an infectious laugh, and I loved, I can still hear it in my mind. But God's so good, and when it was time, God took Ron's hand, and he says, "It's time. Your work is done." And if Ron could say anything to you this morning, and I'm going to close with my part of this, he would tell you, you never know when your time is going to be. If he could speak to you today, he would say, be ready. He would say, be ready. And there's coming a day that we're going to all sit around and we're going to enjoy one another, and it's for eternity. Amen.
Take it easy on the stairs because our family isn't one of grace. I want to start out this morning thanking Dustin for that slideshow that he did. All of our pictures of Ron and Paula and Rich, Ron's senior picture, our wedding pictures are all in storage, packed in storage. So he scrambled to find what we could, and he did an awesome job. Thank you, Dustin, for that. The one picture of Ron with the family on the beach, that's a very special picture. We had a guest that came to our hotel every year, and he goes, "Ron, I want to bring my grandkids. Will you take us clamming?" Ron says, "You bet I will." And this, Ron had started chemo. He wasn't feeling really good, but you would never know it. He did not complain. He did everything he usually did. And he brought his grandkids, and they went out. Ron made sure they all limited out, and they had the best time ever. Just fantastic. The next spring, the grandkids came back, and they had lost their grandfather. And they said, "You know, you made this memory so special. It's one we'll always have." And they just loved on him and thanked him for that. That's the kind of person Ron was. I need to thank everybody for the outpouring of love that we have not experienced before. Staples, where Tana works, the day after Ron passed, brought us a week's worth of food. Valley Christian Center, our home church in Milton Freewater, the pastors were there with us when Ron passed. They have brought us meals, and they have supported us financially, and I just can't say enough. Awakened Church, for all of this, they are amazing. To Paula and Bertie and her family for the refreshments that are going to be served after this service. For Living Word Church of God and their support. For everyone, including Icicle Village, where I'm so much involved with death that I didn't realize. I didn't order flowers or anything, but Icicle Village did. God knows. God knows. So thank you for this beautiful bouquet. We are here today to invite the Holy Spirit into this house of God, to glorify God the Father and Jesus Christ the Son, and to honor Ron Bloom, a faithful servant to our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord for Christian music, because that has really gotten me through this last week. And there's one song, Counting Every Blessing, I'm sure you guys all know it, but there's one verse where it says, "You were there in the valley of shadows, you were there in the depth of my sorrows. You're my strength, my hope for tomorrow, I've been blessed beyond all measure. I am counting every blessing, letting go and trusting when I cannot see. I am counting every blessing, surely every season you are good to me." And this song has just been playing continuously. Anytime I'm in the car, but in my mind when there is no music. So it has really gotten me through this tough time this last week. Ron was a godly man. And he sought God, he lived the walk, he was soft-spoken, he was easy to talk to. Those of you who know me, I don't candy coat things, I'm pretty straightforward, it's pretty black and white usually. So my kids especially would go to Ron, because they could just sit there and talk to him and he would listen, and he always had sound, godly advice to give them. So Monday when he passed, it gave me great pleasure to know the Lord said, "Come home. Come home. You are my good and faithful servant." He now has a castle. He walks on streets of gold, which, by the way, there is no rent, no taxes, no surcharges. It's free because Jesus paid that price for us. But most importantly, he is in the presence of Jesus. My heart grieves, but only my heart grieves, because now he is in heaven. And when you do not know the eternal destination of your loved one, your heart, soul, and spirit grieves. I have a friend whose father was in a coma in the hospital. He knew his father had not accepted Christ as his Lord and Savior, so he talked to his dad. He read him scriptures, and he said the sinner's prayer with him, all while he was in this state of a coma. And his father passed, and he grieved. His heart, his soul, his spirit grieved because he did not know where his father went. And when you ask God to let you know, he is faithful. And the announcement came one day at school, his father had passed. And that night when Tana and I were doing her nightly prayers and tucked her into bed, she got out of bed just as I was leaving the room, and the Holy Spirit just said, you need to write this down. And she prayed a prayer that I have never heard this child pray like before. And basically it was confirmation that his dad in that comatose state did accept Jesus, and he was in heaven. So God is good. God is good. And he can save a soul in the twinkling of an eye. And so, even though my heart grieves, I know where my husband is. Ron's favorite verse was John 10:10, as Sister Dee read. But on the following page, just a few verses down, it says this. Oh, yeah. Well, I did have it. Well, we will find it. Okay, here it is. But a few verses over, it says, "And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand." So that is such great news that he is there. Ron's faith never wavered in his battle with cancer. In fact, many people didn't even know he had cancer. He had the nurses in the chemo department fought to have him as their patient for that day because he would joke with them. He would just be happy. He would just encourage, even though he was not feeling well himself. And he continued to glorify God throughout that. The doctor said, "Ron, I don't even know if I could do what you're doing." He goes, "Well, the reason I can do this is because Jesus is my Lord and Savior, and through him, I can do all things." Ron and I met. I had just gone through a divorce. I was 26. I had two kids. And so I had to get another job because now I was paying all the bills. And I got a job at the cannery. And I was in quality control. I got to test corn. And let me tell you, there is good corn and there is starch. Definite difference. And I would walk out of our little cubicle or our little enclosed area there, and to go take the results to my supervisor, and out of nowhere, I would get pinged with a frozen carrot, and those things leave welts and bruises, and I'm going, what in the world? I mean, you know, is the machine off kilter and throwing them around or whatever? And eventually, I caught him, and he would just be flinging these things at me, and unbeknownst to me, my coworkers in our little area, he was asking them to ask me questions so he could find out about me. And we were friends for quite some time. And then he asked me out. And so we went out. And then a month later, he asked me out again. And he asked me to marry him. And I'm going, whoa. You just graduated from high school and are 19 years old. I'm 26 with two kids. No. And Ron, I broke his heart. And he says, I know what I want. I want you to be my wife, and I will not ask you again. So we went through life for about 7 years, and we kind of split up. And, you know, that sparkling blue eyes and that big, beautiful smile had won my heart. So I asked him to marry me. And I married him by the gist of the peace first, because I didn't want him to change his mind. And that was really the most memorable marriage, because Andersons were there, who were a very huge part of his family. The next year, we got married in the church, and it was fun, but the first one sufficed. Ron and I gave our life to the Lord on his 28th birthday at a Dave Reaver presentation. And if you don't know Dave Reaver, he was the Vietnam vet that was exploded by a bomb, lost his ear, lost part of his face and stuff. But wow, what a testimony. And ever since that point, he just grew in the Lord. He grew in the Lord, and he set such a good example. After T's wedding, things turned. The cancer got control. And months turned into weeks, and overnight turned into hours. And this literally showed up on my porch, but it is so Ron's last final hours. God, you made me from before I was born. You took me through my life. You supported me. You were there with me when I wasn't there with you. There were times I was sick, and you healed me. There were times I was in despair, and you gave me hope. There were times when I felt betrayed, and I could still turn to you. It was a wonderful life. I loved and was loved. I sang, I heard music, I saw flowers. Poor guy, that's because he was married to me. I saw sunrises and sunsets, even in places when I was alone. You, in my heart, helped me turn loneliness into precious solitude. And I took back over the panorama, I look back over the panorama of my life. What a wonderful privilege this was. I still have some concerns for people in the family, for the world, for the planet. I put them in your beloved hands. I trust that whatever in the web of life that needed me to be there is now complete. I thank you for taking the burden from me, and I thank you for keeping me in the light. As I let go, Lord, as I let go, here I am with you, Lord. Ron, I wish we would have had pictures of Ron and Paula and Rich, because they were his kids too. There was no difference. They have memories of camping and fishing that they'll have forever. And his love, he loved them dearly. And life touched so many people, even more people than I was aware of. And so as we just honor him today, and we glorify the Father and the Son for being so good to us, and for guiding us, for their protection. I thank him for protecting each and every one of you that have drove distances to be here today. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And Ron's wish for all those that he cared about was that they would have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ and accept him as their Lord and Savior. And today we're going to have family come up and share. We'll start with our oldest daughter, Paula, and then Tana and Dustin. His brother, Jerry, I'm sorry, a little foggy here, and longtime family friend, Paul Ginneman. And then the floor will be open for you to come up and share your favorite memory. And just remember, this is a celebration of his life. We are here to celebrate Ron's life and to share the joy of Jesus. And and don't be long-winded like me. Just kind of keep it short. I don't know. That's an issue I have, but... I love each and every one of you. And Paula, if you would come up, please, hon. Here's the... Okay.
And then I just tuck it in. And then I okay. Not like my friend's daughter with chips. So I love you, Mama. So I will talk about... I'll try and make this short. So my mom, as she said, got together with Ron when he was 19. So that makes me, seven? So my second grade year, I went to school for show and tell, and I get up in the front and I go, my daddy turned 21 today. And that's a pretty big deal. And the teacher looked at me. Mom got a call, so I come firing in the door, and I go, guess what I said for show and tell today? And I tell the story of how my daddy turned 21. She's like, that'd make you like 12 or 11 when she was born. And so mom got the call, and she goes, oh, my gosh, I'm sorry. That's her stepdad. You know, I'm sorry that alarmed you. And so, yeah, that was, we had many of those crazy phone calls, actually, but we won't go into those. I'm trying to save face here. We're not going to talk about all the calls home. So Ron had this red Toyota pickup truck with this bulldog on it, and it was like this all the time on the front of the hood. What do you call those metal things that are on the hoods? And what was that? I don't know. Anyways, like a hood ornament. And so every time we'd walk by it, we'd go, get in the car. And one day he's sitting in there, and he watched. He knew I was going to come in. The dog, and he goes, Bert! And I was like, fell over backwards, and he was laughing so hard. He was just like, he was so proud of himself. So we were fishing, because he always wanted to go fishing, and my brother and I loved the lizards. So I go walking out on this log, and I'm being all quiet, and they're all fishing over here and doing their thing. And I went to bend down and get this lizard, and I flipped sideways and fell on the log and flipped into the water, and I look up, and he's belly laughing. He goes, I saw you the whole time. Did you think I can't see you? And so it was, he always had the best sense of humor, and I was always in trouble. Like the time he caught my friend smoking and smacked her in the back of the head. And he's like, when I was a kid, when I got caught doing this, they made us eat these cigarettes. And he just looked at us and was like, oh my gosh. But no, Ron and I would always call him to ask questions because I knew Mom would lecture me. So I would call Ron, and we'd have good 30, 45-minute conversations. And then I'd try to call Mom, and then I'd call Tana, and neither of them would answer their phone. So I'd call Ron, and I'm like, our family should not have phones. He goes, I know, they should never have cell phones. They never answer them. But so Ron and I would end up talking for a good 40 minutes about everything that's going on, and he always wanted to know about my kids, hear the stories about the kids. He's the best. I'm so blessed to have somebody who we get to role model that is such a positive, amazing human that never said a bad thing about anybody. Even when his car got wrecked or anything, he's like, well, you know, those are replaceable. It's all good. You know, and when our car got wrecked, I was so mad. He's like, but are you fine? Yeah. Are your kids fine? Yeah. Nothing to be worried about. So we had that as a foundation, and it's so good to build off that foundation with my own offspring. I feel blessed. Thank you, everybody. I'll pass the mic. Richard or Tana? Oh, Tana. Tana.
Yeah, you're going up with me. We'll see how I do here. My dad was the definition of strength. Like my sister said, he liked to play jokes a lot. Our favorite one was in Seaside. He made his own Piccolo Pete bombs. And Danny, Dustin, and I were just getting out of the truck, and he chucked it right, like, just behind my truck, and it went off. And Danny dove into the back of the truck. Dustin hit the ground, and I was the only one like this. Like, what is happening? And my dad's just dying of laughter because we're all just, like, screaming, freaking out, like, oh, my gosh, the world's ending. And he would chase Dustin with crabs because Dustin hates crabs. Like, he was dead asleep, and my dad's like, and comes over and holds it to Dustin's face. And I've never seen him jump so high or so far. And it was just like, that was my dad. He liked to joke. He loved to, I was sleeping on the couch, not even doing anything, and you scream. So you don't count. My dad, if anyone who knows my dad, he was all about hunting, fishing, camping. It was always outdoors. It was always having fun, spending time with family. There's so many memories. But the first Father's Day after my dad found out he had cancer, I actually forgot I wrote this poem that I had given him. The first part is like sorry there's no fancy card. This is, you know, I wanted to write this for you. You're the best dad ever. You know, the typical Father's Day card that kids write their parents. I'll try to make it through the poem. It has a lot more depth and meaning now. And my mom found it in my dad's top sock drawer closest to the bed that he's kept this whole time he's been going through chemo and cancer. It was a poem I wrote called A True Father. And it says, he's her hunting partner, best friend, knight in shining armor. He bandages her wounds, loves her, and teaches her how to be a fighter. He teaches her how to gut her own deer, put a worm on a hook, even how to fire his revolver. He's taught her how to camp, survive, and be ready for whatever may come. But one thing he's shown her is how to be richer, not by money or things on earth, but a godly follower and leader. This is her father, her role model, who's helped her be an overcomer. He's shown her how a father should love his daughter. And even though she may not always listen to what he tells her, she will always be his best friend and love him forever. He is her superhero from beginning to end. He is her mentor, an example of one's strength. No words can say, no actions can show how thankful she is for the love of her unrelenting father. He's sacrificed and given up many different things just to make sure that she would never stray. So now she will get back and proudly say, I love you, Papa. Happy Father's Day. My dad was my best friend, and everyone knows that we did everything together. I have no words. This is the closest I could get. So this poem definitely holds a lot more depth and meaning to me now. I know Dustin wanted to share some stuff, so.
So, I'm kind of glad things worked out the way they did. When Tana and I met, and I came down for the first time, I didn't really have a good idea as to what I was walking into as far as the Bloom family and all the connections that they have. I had written a little bit of a speech, but I'm just going to kind of go through it. And one of the biggest things about Ron was he wanted you to be you. When he was making friends and he was talking with you, he wanted the real you. And that's one of the things that he could always see in me. You know, when I met him for the first time, I was immature and childish. And, you know, I came down because I met her online and we just wanted to meet, you know. But regardless of that, regardless of my reasoning, he welcomed me into the house. He began to imprint on my life without me knowing that he was doing it, and for the better of the entire time. I remember from day one, the smile that he had. That was his biggest trait. Then the fact that, as Santa said, he would love the opportunity to grab a crab and scare me with it. But my most favorite memory is actually one that involved me and him directly, about you. I had been with T for, I think it was going on 5 years, it was about four and a half. And I knew that I couldn't really stall it any longer. I had to sit down and have a one-to-one conversation with him. He knew that this was coming. I sat him down, I said, I wanted to talk to you. And I had a whole drawn-out speech, and it was kind of overdone and way too prepared for what he prefers, like I said, the real you. And when I got around to asking, I said, so with this, I want to bring it to your attention. He kind of stopped me in my tracks, and he said, do you want to marry my daughter? He'd read my mind. And that's one of the things that he was the best at. Him and I used to play chess. That was one of his favorite pastimes. And T isn't really the whole patient type, so chess isn't really up her field. But he loved having someone to play a game with, someone to sit down, you know, for half hour, 45 minutes, and play chess. He was kind of surprisingly good at it too, kind of like Deb and Yahtzee. But I realized after playing with him for, you know, 6-7 months, he applied those strategies to life. When I walked in to this family, I had not yet given myself to Christ. But the entire time, he knew that. He was using those strategies. He was using that experience in combination with Tana to help bring me to that. And I can say happily that because of those factors is part of the reason why I came to Christ. But long story short, I love the conversations that we have. He always wanted to know more. He was always interested in what I was doing, how my family was, and he had never met him. As Deb said, the heart grieves, but neither the body or the spirit does, for we know where he is. And through this grief, we still see smiles, because he's not. He's not hurting. The best that I can do is be here with and for this family that he made me a part of. And love on them as they did me. That's all I have.
Thank you, Uncle Jerry. I'm gonna try not to break my neck.
Well, you talk about memories. I could probably tell you a few things about what we did to Ron when he was young, but we're not. The biggest memory I have of my brother is that he had the most infectious smile. You couldn't help it. When they were down at Seaside and we would walk through the door, he would just bust into a grin. And we would sit down in them hard stools for hours and hours and talk. And then he got cancer. Now, I don't like cancer. In fact, I'll point blank, I'll say it. I hate cancer. Cancer destroys life. And for a long time, I prayed and prayed to God to heal Ron. And at T's wedding, the pastor of the church here, him and I were talking in the kitchen. And I said, you know, I pray and pray. I pray every day to heal Ron. And the pastor said, Jerry, maybe him healing Ron isn't to go on in this life. Maybe it's for him to call Ron home. And it hit me. And so I'm just going to keep this short. I've got his memory, his smile, smiling all the time. And one saying he always said to me, every time we talked, one of his favorite sayings seemed to be, it is what it is. Thank you.
Well, I had the privilege of knowing Ron for the last 20 years. He and I worked together when Ron managed the iSchool Junction up in Leavenworth, and then when he and Debbie managed the Seashore Inn down in Seaside. But our relationship, even from the very beginning, there was a lot more to it than work, and it was a special connection, and I know we had some common background, but I think from the very beginning, we knew we were brothers in the Lord. And there was that special connection with Ron that I'll never forget. Like many of you, I mean, this is a tough time. A lot of us are going through tough times for different reasons. Last week, I was going through a very tough time, and the Spirit sent me a message out of Proverbs 24:10, which says, those that are weak in crisis are weak indeed. So Lord, I pray for your strength for all of us this morning, and just pray that whatever these words that are spoken are your words, Lord. So a lot of times, people who are soft-spoken, who are kind, who live, it is what it is, are thought of as being weak. But Ron was one of the strongest men I know. Down at the seashore, when he took over the seashore, and sorry for bringing up bad memories, Debbie, but when they took over, the managers who were there before decided about 3 weeks ahead of their departure time that, I guess we made a mistake. We don't want to leave. So they made it as hard as it could be on Ron and Debbie, and hoping that they would decide we shouldn't be here. We're going back up north. But a weaker man would have said, yeah, I give up. But Ron continually told me, I know this is where the Lord wants me to be. So he persevered, and Ron really came into his own at the seashore, I thought. He led a great group of people there. He learned how to fire people. Deb and Tana could share, he could write a book of crazy things that hotel guests do. But Ron persevered through it all with a smile on his face. And like I say, he really came into his own. He really helped take the seashore to a whole different level. Then there was the strength that Ron exhibited in his cancer fight for over 6 years. I check in with Ron and say, how's it going, Ron? And he says, well, they're doing this treatment, they're doing that treatment. And as you all know, there are very nasty side effects to chemo and the different treatments he was going through. And I'd say, Ron, well, how you really feeling, Ron? And you know, he'd say, yeah, you know, there's tough days. He's human, just like the rest of us. He was human. He had tough days. He was tired and different things. But every single time, the ending message was, whatever the Lord's plan is fine with me. He's either going to heal me here or he's going to heal me up there. And what a fantastic example of faith for all of us. Ron was one of those people that he didn't just talk the talk, he really walked the talk. You knew Ron was a man of faith. Everything that Ron had belonged to the Lord. I think there's people down in Seaside watching this, I'm pretty sure. And you know how generous he was with you guys down there. And Ron was more than generous sharing his faith with the people he worked with there, with guests, with nurses. Just an absolutely amazing man. Again, what an example for us. And so, you know, I think about how do you sum up Ron's life in a few short minutes? And it came to me, Ray Bolts, I think it is, wrote a song 20 plus years ago that's titled Thank You for Giving to the Lord. And I'd sing it for you, but half of you would leave. But the essence of the song is, you know, the guy gets up to heaven and there's somebody waving to him and saying, thank you for giving to me, touching me, helping bring me to the Lord. And there's another person waving and saying, thank you for touching my life and bringing me to the Lord. And pretty soon, there's a multitude of people waving to the guy saying, thank you for giving to the Lord. And so when I think of Ron, you know, my heart hurts that he's gone. But my mind's going to focus on, I've got a picture in my mind of Ron walking down the streets of gold next to Jesus, and all these people waving at him, saying, thank you for giving to the Lord. And the Lord saying, great is thy reward. Yeah. And great is Ron's reward up there. Thank you, Ron, for giving to the Lord. Thank you for giving to all of us here and online. What a great, great, great man, a great, great example. We'll see you again someday, Ron. And thinking, I'd love to play softball up there with you, Ron. Maybe in the state of Montana that's part of heaven. Who knows?
Thanks. Thank you. We're now going to open the floor for anyone that would want to share. And one moment, this big, handsome guy is coming.
Hello. My name is Paula's husband. And no, I'm not a brother of Ron. I don't like getting up and doing this stuff. My wife knows this is just not me. And I only come up here when I'm called to come up here. Okay. I need you guys to do something for me. I need you all to stand up, please. What we're going to do is called a two-clap boom. All right? Goes like this. I say two claps. You go, boom. Okay? Two clap, boom. Two clap, boom. Two clap, boom. It's been difficult for me. You can all sit down now. It's been difficult as me, I mean, especially now in the last year of my life, to be going around saying, how do I become a man? How do I become a husband, a father, and a man? And my father is a wonderful person, and he taught me as much as he could. But one man cannot teach another everything to know. And Ron has taught me how to be a great stepfather to my stepson. He has taught me how to be a man of faith. My father was not a man of faith, is not a man of faith. But Ron is a man of faith. And I am up here speaking because of Ron. And I honor him. And I love him as a man and as a father to those of you that are here. So I'm going to do this one more time to salute Ron as a man and a father and a husband. Okay? Ron. Two clap, boom. Two clap, boom. Two clap, boom. Thank you.
He loves it. So we are opening. If anybody would love to share a special memory of Ron, please go ahead and come on up.
You'll have to excuse me. I don't do this very often. I was never good at public speaking, just like Paula's husband. my wife, Danny, and I moved in February, and that was the time that I actually got to know Ron. To this day, I don't know him very well, but I know in the mornings he would like to sit on the porch and just look at the sky in silence. And that's it. Sorry. That's a gift that he gave me. I was always held up in my room. I was extremely reclusive. It's normally how I am whenever I go to a new place. And one morning I decided to just sit out there with him. I know he's a good conversationalist, but he and I never had that many conversations. Instead, he and I would just sit in silence sometimes. And the day after his passing, I went out to the porch, and I sat down. And I sat there for the longest time. And I saw one of the doves that fly by, and I was thinking, ooh, I should tell Ron about that. And I kind of hit me there. Other than the fact that I'm pretty sure he already knew it was there. Later on that day, I decided I wanted to sit on the porch again. And there was the most beautiful sunset that I've ever seen. It was just a mix of orange and pinks and blues. And the last time I got to saw that with him was the last time I sat out there with him. And it really meant a lot to me. And it really gave out quite a bit of memories. Some memories I wish I was more involved in. Some memories I wish I had gotten to know him more. I know he touched a lot of people. he had, in the short time that he had touched me as well. And I'm very thankful for that gift of observation, that gift of silence that he gave me, just to admire all of God's creations, all of God's gifts.
Would anybody else like to share today? Yeah, no, you don't have to.
Ron was a good friend. Let's go back. Tana, how old were you at Christmas, this past Christmas? You're 24? No, 24. 24. Backtrack about 19 years ago, I believe would have been the first time that I met Ron and Debbie and Tana at my mom and dad's apartment in Kashmir. They'd invited Ron and Debbie and Tana over for Christmas dinner. Dad always said, if you're going to do Christmas and you expect Grandpa to be there, we'll have it at Grandpa's house. I fell in love with Tana. She started calling me Uncle Bruce. Out in the lobby today, I said, Tana, do you remember me? I saw her at her wedding. Before that, I hadn't seen her for a few years in Seaside. But I fell in love with Debbie and Ron. Ron was not only a godly man, he loved people. I was going through some tough times. Family members that I had not thought would have said some of the things that they did, they did. I was living in the same complex as my dad. Was living with him for a while, and somebody looked at the books and, hey, he's not on the lease. He either needs to move into another room, or he needs to go somewhere else. So I waited for an opening. I moved in where my dad, I lived right around the corner from him. I was going through those tough times. I'm not going to say what they were. I went over crying to Dad. And Dad says, do you want me to call Pastor Bob? I says, no, Dad. Now, don't get me wrong. I have nothing against Pastor Bob. But I want Ron. Dad called Ron. Within 15 minutes, Ron was at our door. And I told him what was said. A lot's been said about Ron being a godly man. I believe he was a praying man, Debbie. I'm sure that Ron prayed. My dad was a best friend of Paula's. He loved her. But he told his family members to lay off with what some of the things that were being said to me and about me. And it wasn't long after that I was at this person's house. We'd come back from somewhere I was driving, and she hesitated. You may know who it is now, but you may not even. She says, is everything okay with us? I said, yeah. Jesus took care of it. Why? Because Ron was there with me, and I'm sure that he prayed. I only saw Ron once, actually twice down in Seaside. I stayed at the motel the first time, the second time, just trying to find a place to stay on a Labor Day weekend. Don't try to travel in Oregon on the coastline in on a Labor Day weekend. You will not find a place. I went all the way down, almost down to, way down past about Lincoln City, ended up going way back north before I, you know, found a place to stay. But anyway, Ron was a good man. I love him. We're going to miss him. And that's all I've got to say, Debbie.
Thank you. Thank you. Would anybody else like to share today? Okay.
One final thing that I wanted to mention, and I forgot to when I was up there, is about Ron's care, his giving, and his ability to go above and beyond, you know, with the call of duty and what was asked of him. It's kind of rocked the world of, you know, the Bloom House when it happened. But after Ron had passed, we got a piece of mail in our box. It was from a place called the Shire of Montana. And we were confused because that was a location that we had discovered after Tan and I got married that we thought would be a really good place to have that done. So we as a family took interest into it and wanted to go there, kind of see what it was like. So we opened up the mail, and I'm going to paraphrase it a little bit. Basically, he said to this effect, for my wife's and my anniversary this year, the 3-day trip had been paid in full by Ron. And the word had got to them of his passing. So they said, as a final gift, your anniversary has been paid in full by Ron Bloom. May you rest in peace. He always went above and beyond. He loves to love people. And I think that's the way he wants to be remembered.
And just so everybody knows here, they've been grafted into the Bloom family. That means you can never leave it. So just so you know.
Wow. I think everybody got the picture. Everybody share the story of who Ron is. I get to conclude this. And, you know, I love what Chris did. A lot of people, we come to a funeral and we have the ability to be sad because we are sad. But you see, in Christ, when you know Jesus, when you've given your life to Jesus, we don't sorrow like the world. We actually have a different kind of grief, because for us, it's not goodbye, but it is bye-bye for now. In the book of Thessalonians, this is what it says in 1 Thessalonians 4, from 13 to 14. It says, and now, dear brothers and sisters, we want you to know what will happen to the believers who have died, so you will not grieve like people who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and was raised to life again, we also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring back with him the believers who have died. So we as believers, like Paul said, O death, where is your sting? For us that know Jesus Christ, for us that have given our life to him, death has no sting. The grave has no power because Jesus Christ has defeated death once and for all. Can we give it up for Jesus right now? Death has no power here because from the stories I have heard, Ron gave his life to Jesus Christ, and he has one message for you here today. Do you know his Savior? Do you have the hope that he has? Because there's only one way, one truth, one life, and his name is Jesus Christ. So I've heard it said today that his desire is that everybody knows he's Jesus Christ. And I think I'm going to do that today. Because some of you have come to celebrate his life. But Ron is no longer in the grave. He's alive. The Bible says the moment he closed his eyes in this life, the next moment he opened his eye and he was with Jesus Christ. But do you have that assurance? Do you have that hope? Because Ron started a journey and he ended the journey, but you are still on a journey right now. And Ron will say to you today, if you want to see me again one day, you need to make Jesus the Lord and Savior of your life. That will be his message for you today. Not religious of coming to church and reading the Bible and everything, but having a relationship with Jesus Christ. So I'm going to invite you to that adventure, and then we're going to close. So can we have all our eyes closed? If you're here and you've never known or believed in Jesus Christ that Ron believed in, if you don't have the hope that your tomorrow is secured, if you don't have the belief that if you close your eyes today, you'll be with Jesus, I want to invite you. The Bible says 2,000 and something years ago, God gave his one and only son to die, to take our place. That if we repent of our sins, he'll forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. If you're here and you want to know Ron's God and his son, Jesus Christ, I'm going to invite you wherever you are, if you want to give your life to Jesus, to put your hands up so I can pray with you. If you want to give your life to Jesus today, wherever you are, you can put your hands up. There's somebody. Okay, thank you. Who else wants to give their life? Thank you. Somebody else. I see you. Thank you. Who else wants to give their life to Jesus today? I see you. Who else? Don't worry. No one is looking. This is between you and Jesus. I see four hands. Who else wants to give their life? Thank you. Who else wants to give their life to Jesus? Oh, my goodness. Just put your hands up. Don't worry. This is your day. Who else wants to give their life to Jesus? For all of you that have your hands up, I'm going to just ask you to say this prayer. Say, Jesus, forgive me of all my sins. I believe you died for me and you rose again. Today, I say I'm sorry and I give you my life and I ask you to be my Savior. In Jesus' name. Amen. Can we get up and clap for everyone that just gave their life to Jesus Christ? Can we just do that here? Can we get up and clap for Ron? He's in heaven. And there are new people in the church today that are making the decision to go without God. Today was a celebration of life. Today was the day that God came to give beauty from ashes. Today was the day that God came to give life from death. I want to say thank you on behalf of Debbie and her family. Thank you for coming from far to come and celebrate. But this is just the beginning. The family would like to invite you to sign the guest books before you leave. But we're not done celebrating. After you sign the guest book, across at the park, we have some like delicious snacks. We want to talk more. We want to share. We don't want you to just take off. The family wants to just hear more stories about Ron that you have, because some of you did not get up today, and that's okay. But after this service, I want to dismiss and say, don't forget to sign the book, and then don't forget to join us in the park as we celebrate Ron. Okay? Paula, do you have any other thing as we dismiss? No? Well, you're dismissed. Come on, can we give Ron one more clap and thank God?